thanks for tuning in. You may not recognize us. We finally moved out of Luis's bedroom and into our new set, but this is Magic TV. I'm the guy on the left, Mashi Scanlan. This, with me as always, is my sidekick, LSV.
Got a new sidekick here.
Humphrey, our money tree. We have to feed him so that he gives us our money.
So we've got some interesting stuff to talk about today. Pretty much all Zendikar related, which probably doesn't come as a surprise.
It's two of my favorite topics, Zendikar and Mythics. Because we had the Baneslayer discussion and Luis was wrong about that. And with Zendikar we have enemy fetch lands and Luis was wrong about that.
I don't know if there's any record of me. Oh wait, there's like videos and two articles. Where I speculated these wouldn't come back. I was clearly wrong, but you know.
They're back. It's an interesting thing.
Lifetime mistake count up to two.
Well, then there's the new haircut.
Well, yeah.
So, you know, with the enemy fetches, it's crazy. You know, I'm a retailer. We're selling these cards. They sell well. But the player in me really, and I know this is a common theme on the internet, really, really wanted to see extended without fetch lands.
Yeah. It's funny because, like, type two, the fetches are good. Like, they make the M10 duels better. They make landfall better. Like,
sure.
They make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And extended, they're certainly good, but it would have been a little interesting. Like, we did a little testing pre-fetch land, and the decks were different. And
wasted time.
Yeah, but I mean, who's to say my time is that valuable anyway?
Not many, I'll tell you that.
But having the extended with the fetch lands, it would have been nice to see it without it.
Definitely.
And I mean, like, at this point, these are going to be in for the next 7 years or something.
Yeah, forget it. Fetch lands are here to stay. You know, fetch lands with Ravnica block duels. You know.
At least now, so now we're waiting for the Ravnica block duels to rotate, which is going to be a while.
Yeah.
And another 3 or 4 years at least.
By then, who knows what's going to come out.
Right.
And what you say about type two is true. I mean, having the fetches in type two is great. You know, it's
having
awesome
guys
there.
Like plated GOP would be a beating. Mm-hmm. It's fine. I mean, you want your new cards to be good. Like, I guess I'm not too thrilled about red 2-drops getting better, but, you know.
Well, or red 1-drops and that 2-2 Haster.
Goblin Guide, is nice, I think.
But, you know, one kind of wonders when you look at the set, I mean, we already have Tri-Lands from Shards. We have the M10 duels. There are these new, you know.
The come into play tap, the invasion duels where you gain a life, which seem very good also, but we'll get to those in a sec.
And with those three in there, it's almost like these fetch lands are kind of just shoehorned in there.
Well, no, I thought that too, because, like, it doesn't seem like there's much tension, like, in Zendikar to play enemy colors. Like, why would you want to play black-green or black-white or whatever?
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have enough of the set, but it doesn't look like that's really a theme. They're just lands. On the other hand, we've already got a ton of rewards for playing allied colors. Like, if you were playing Grixis, you could play Crumbling Necropolis, you could play Dragon Skull Summit, you could play Drowned Catacombs, and you have the new duels that tap for, you know, black-blue or black-red. But if you wanted to play, say, red-blue-green, you had really no good options. You could play red-green duels, that's about it. These new fetch lands make it a lot easier. You get green, blue, and blue, red. And that's good. It means that it's opening up all the different colors to having fixing without having fixing as good as Vivid Reflecting Pool.
So, I mean, how are you, I mean, you're, I mean, I don't know if it's just the way you contextualize it for this discussion. You're saying it's going to help three color mana bases where they're playing off colors?
Yeah. I mean, it'll help two color, like, you can make a black-white deck with better mana than you could have without the black-white fetch land. Like,
right.
Like, in Josh Utterleighton's article this week, he had a black-white deck, and the mana base was like 10 planes, 11 swamps, and 4 black-white fetches. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's possible he wants to play
Arcane Sanctum,
the Esper land also. But, you know, in two-color decks, the fixing helps, but you're going to see it most in the three-color decks where you get a bunch of fetches.
Yeah, I mean, it just, I understand what you're saying. It's just that it seems like, first of all, I thought there would be some hesitancy when we are exiting this era of Vivid Lands and Reflecting Pools to kind of put so many non-basics in there, so much mana fixing. And it seemed like there was a lot. Every set, it has dual lands, it seems like. You know?
Yeah, but these dual lands are a lot more restricted in scope. Like, before, if you wanted to play three colors, you might as well play five, because you're going to play a bunch of coming to play tap lands.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can play Grixis and play Cruel Ultimatum, and your mana base is going to be decent.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't play Grixis and play Baneslayer Angel, which you could before.
Yeah, it was,
and
it was
I think I like the word mana fixing is now. There's enough fixing that you can have good mana bases. Mm-hmm. I don't like it when you've got to play, like, you know, a ton of basics and just get mana scroll the time.
Right,
there's enough good duels. But there's also not so much mana fixing that you can just play five colors. Like, it's actually balanced well.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason I like the fetch lands. Again, extended, it would have been nice to see fairies without Tarmogoyf automatically, you know.
So this is one of those rare environments with a mana base that's going to get the LSV seal of approval, because it seems like recently it's just been don't like this mana base, don't like that mana base.
It's mostly the reflecting pools and stuff.
It's the type 2 stuff.
Yeah.
So Zendikar is also bringing us, as more and more comes out, we know so many of the mythics at this point.
Yeah, and there's a couple of mythics in particular that seem a little odd that they're chosen to be mythic, because they go a little against what, you know, we had thought mythics were going to be based on statements Wizards made, like Mindbreak Trap.
And War Instigator.
Yeah, like, they're both good cards. Mm-hmm. Mindbreak actually seems mythic in flavor. Like,
yeah.
It's pretty epic.
It's
like,
it has a huge effect, like, when it splashes.
Yeah,
in
and
there,
it does a lot of powerful things. War Instigator mm-hmm. doesn't even seem like a mythic card. Like, it's a goblin that goes and rings a dinner bell.
Come and get it.
Yeah.
Both those cards have the potential to see a lot more play in the Eternal formats. Do you think that's a move Wizards is making?
I'm not overly thrilled with Mindbreak Trap in Eternal formats.
Well, it seems like against Storm, game over, right?
Well, so is Trickbind and Stifle, and like, both those things eventually get duressed. It's not like you can't play sideboard cards against Storm because they'll duress you, but you want proactive ones like Canonist, Arcane Lab, your own duresses. Mm-hmm. That stops them from comboing off. Mm-hmm. Whereas Mindbreak Trap, they're often going to, you know, use their card draw engines, duress you, and then go off. Like, having a reactive card that only works when they cast their kill card, Tendrils, mm-hmm. although it actually works against Yogg-Will also, but
right.
It's just not that good.
So, you're saying this is, like, you know, not even one of the top 5 options against Storm in an Eternal format?
No, it might very well be within the top 5, and it might be playable, but I don't think it's, like, the second coming of anything. It's just not, like, an auto sideboard card. It's not a card I'd worry about you having to pick up a playset.
Sure.
Warden Stater seems pretty good, like, in Legacy. Hitting, putting a Matron to play, getting, you know, Siege Gang, putting it into play,
Yeah,
etc. They both seem like the kind of card that, again, shouldn't be mythic necessarily. Like, Mindbreak seems like it's going to see quite a bit of Type 2 and some extended play.
Yeah.
And War Instigator, I think, is overrated, but if it does see play, it's going to see a lot of play.
I think the jury's still out on that. That's a very, very... That card seems very dependent on what
I'm
else
not overly thrilled with it, but it's also the kind of card people like. People like Goblin Lackey.
It's a red creature. When was the last time you were thrilled about a red creature?
Never, and I'm not, but...
See, there you go.
Goblin Welder.
Urza's Block.
Yeah,
Child,
yeah.
Please.
But it's the kind of card even casual players will want, and like, making it mythic just seems kind of weird. I don't see why it necessarily has to be mythic. It doesn't feel mythic.
I agree with that, and the only reason it's
far be it from me to be the arbiter of flavor, but this still
this doesn't feel mythic. Make it a rare.
But it doesn't.
I agree with you.
If I can see that, then I can imagine a lot of people.
That's why I wonder: is it a move, you know, to maybe make those spells and those creatures that are could see play more in the Eternal formats mythic?
I don't know if they're necessarily looking at it, like, necessarily through the lens of Eternal, but I like it when they make cards that are playable in Eternal and playable in Type 2. Like, that's nice.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it seems like they are, every once, they're popping up more and more now, 1%. You know, the first time was like Painter's Servant in Shadowmoor.
Yeah.
Shot through the roof, and I was like, this isn't really good in Type 2, but it's amazing in the Eternal format.
So I believe someone won a PTQ with Painter's Servant, Chaotic Backlash.
Yeah, it did happen eventually. Eventually, it did see play.
But that's
of course.
Not. Yeah.
It's weird when they do this with the mythics that may see play in Eternal formats. Just because, like, foil Mindbreak Trap now, foil Warren.
Yeah, that is true. I hadn't thought of that. Like, the Eternal formats are where people want their foils. I'm guilty of that myself.
Right. Those are going to go way up.
Yeah. And that's good though, like, because that gives people who don't play Eternal formats a little payday when they get one in a draft.
That's true. It's funny. They never know it though. You know, they look at it as another junk card, and it's like, you know, what's this going to do? So jumping back.
Yeah, I've definitely got Inkwell Leviathans, like, you know, very, very late foil ones, which are, you know, reasonably popular in Vintage.
Well, that's kind of on again off. We've gone from like Colossus to Inkwell Leviathan.
Yeah, but it's definitely bordering on playability all the time.
Right,
so.
Right. Jumping back to the Invasion Duels, the first thing I thought when I saw those was, you know, we have the M10 duels, and obviously the mana base thing is going to be an issue.
Doubling up on them is good. Gaining a life is kind of cool though. It definitely makes them pretty good. I think in general I'm pretty happy with them. There's not a whole lot to say about them. They're pretty simple. But
yeah, they're in there. The M10 duels are in there. We've got the fetch lands. So
basically, we're going to see people casting a lot of spells for not much cost, which is nice.
Right, right. That's going to be good.
One last note about Zendikar. It seems like the name was chosen that you can make a ton of puns on the name.
Zendikar.
Yeah.
It's true. We'll leave that for next time though. Thanks for tuning in.
I've got so many ideas.
Tune in next week where Luis has fun with the name Zendikar.
Thanks for watching.
Money tree. Just ahead of the money tree.
For a second.
Pretty sure it's male. I don't know. I'm thinking of a good name. Humphrey.
I was going to say Arnold, but
no. It's not a, it's like a H, like Herbert, Humphrey, Hauser.
Hauser? No, it's there. Doogie Hauser.
It seems more like guns, like Hausers, you know? Harold?
Humphrey might be better.
Humph. The Humph. The Humphinator.
You guys
Humph!
You guys
ready? Yeah, we're good.